So Fabian is going to be talking about building reproducible distributed applications at scale.
Yes.
Cool.
So
all yours. Good luck.
Okay, thanks. So thanks for having me at EuroPython. I'm going to talk about reproducible distributed applications at scale. About myself, some words about myself. I'm a software engineer at Criteo in Paris, and I'm working on the machine learning platform. You can find me on Twitter and GitHub. And what is Criteo? Criteo is a major advertising company with offices in France and the US. We are about 600 engineers and about 100 engineers working on machine learning stuff. So we don't deploy our tools in the cloud. We have our own on-premise Hadoop cluster with 3,000 nodes. So every day we process the petabytes of data. So not in one job, but at the end of the day, we have processed petabytes of data. So scale is something we need. So this is the tools we deploy for our machine learning platform. We are big users of Apache Spark. So we use it for analytics, data processing. We have our own models built into ML models built into Apache Spark. We use TensorFlow for deep learning, scikit-learn for some smaller models, Jupyter and JupyterHub for experimenting, Pandas, Matplotlib for visualization and displaying the metrics, and MLflow for the whole workflow. We're also contributors to MLflow, made quite a lot of contributions. So in this talk, I will mostly speaking about how to run a PySpark job on a cluster. That's because we are big users of Spark, but you will see at the end, basically all those IDs, they also apply to TensorFlow if you want to run TensorFlow or Dask or PyTorch. It's basically the same ideas, and we're also using this for other tools. So when you want to run on a cluster, it's particular because you're not in your local environment. So basically generally what you have some kind of distributed storage and some compute nodes. And so let's take an example. So what I will try to do is just execute the PySpark example from the documentation. I will use a Pandas UDF. What they also call vectorized UDF. So what is this? You know, historically Spark has been implemented in Scala, and then they just added the Python layer on top. So basically what this means is when you want to execute some custom Python functions, your execution flow is in Scala, in Java on the JVM. And then it means you have to serialize your data in both Python and then serialize back when you get the output. And historically, this was quite slow. So then they added the pandas or vectorized UDF, which means that you can directly work on vectors on pandas series, which is much more efficient. And also they used Apache Arrow, which is an efficient in-memory storage format to pass data between Scala and Python. So this gets now much more efficient and it's working quite nicely. So what I will do here, quite an example, it's not so important. It's more about having some real use case. I will use a grouped aggregate, just create a data frame with two columns. And then for each group, I will compute my mean function, meanfn, and my custom Python function and just compute the mean. So I can execute this now on my local machine. I can do this just with the Spark shell. So I just execute locally, execute it, and I get my pandas data frame. So for one, I get 1.5 is the mean, 2.6 is mean. So what happens now? I want to execute this on the cluster. In my case, well, our cluster is already set up. So Apache Yarn is the scheduler of Hadoop. So if I just set a flag to Yarn, it will be deployed to our cluster. And if I just execute this now, what you get is something like this. So it won't find your PyArrow implementation because what I said before, you use PyArrow to make this vectorized UDF work. So why doesn't it work? It's because locally you have installed all the dependencies, you have installed PySpark, PyArrow, Pandas. So, but when you're on the cluster, you just get only the plain Python interpreter, and when Spark tries to execute your task, it won't find it. So take the example from the doc, it won't work. what you could do now is, well, you can just install on each compute node, you install PyAero and PySpark. And then when you try to run it again, it will find them. Also some words about the Spark submit. You know, the standard Python way is to deploy your jobs is by using Spark submit, which is a bit more complicated than the default MPI use case. So basically what you do, you call Spark submit, then you call your entry point. Your entry point will contain, will get your Spark session, and then you will define your transformations and actions. Then you give this to Spark submit. Spark submit will take care of putting it to your distributed storage, instances, your execution graph, create your executors, and your task. And then your tasks will start running in Java. And then, when you need to hook back into the Python interpreter and execute your mean function, Spark will just call the Python interpreter with some Spark module. Then we'll get the function and pipe STD in and get the STD out. So it's not that important. What is just important is you have a way to invoke the, you call your script, you define your execution graph, Spark will ship it, and then Spark will call the Python interpreter and try to execute a function. So if you install just PyAero and PySpark on your machine level, it will work out. So what happens now? You want to use another version of Spark. So you basically screwed because you have installed Spark, for example, Spark 2.4 and want to install, use Spark 2.4.5. So yeah, you can take your whole cluster down and put it back again, and then want to have another job with another library, or you'd label your nodes somehow and have specific nodes, but it's not really, it's not scaling, it's not really working. Don't forget also that in reality, your Python environment will look something like this. So a huge dependency graph, and I'm sure everybody of you already has encountered this. You have a huge dependency graph locally, you have your environment, and then you install something and you just can't because of conflicting dependencies. So also it won't scale. So the way out of it is using Python virtual environments, which is quite cool. I guess everybody of you knows this, but so it's quite a nice way. You just isolate your environments in a separate repo. You put a link to your Python interpreter, and then your Python interpreter will just find everything related to this repo. So what you could just do now is like you install dedicated virtual environments for each Spark version. And then some other thing you have is like you have an end variable, which is called PySpark underscore Python. And when you launch this, when you set this before the Spark submit, what it will just do, it will instruct Spark to use this interpreter. So you can just target the Python interpreter of your local environment. And then when you do Spark submit, it will target the right one. So it will work. It will, usually it works for two jobs, different versions. Don't forget about the life cycle of all the stuff. So if you just do it once, then you have the problem of how to release them. And so you could just say you do it as a pre and post scrap hook of your script. So first you install your virtual environment and then you target it, and at the end you release everything. But it's not so easy to do this with Spark because everything you do, it's about task level. So you generally don't reason about what you really execute. Also what happens, so now we in the mode where we install our dependencies all the time. What happens if you want to, if a new PySpark version is released? Like some weeks ago, they released PySpark 3.0.0. And so you tested everything with Spark 2.4, and now a new version is released, and it won't behave the same way. Also something I copied from Spark, I copied from some Spark ticket. So what can also happen, you create your executor, you have all your tasks that are running, and then your pip will use some shared cache. And so it can happen, they will all access concurrently to it. And in some cases you can raise conditions, and then the job will just get stuck. It won't even fail, it will just stuck and run forever. It's quite nasty because you don't know when it happens. And when it happens, what can you do? You can do some monitoring, but it's quite an ugly bug. Let's come back to the title. So we want to build distributed applications at scale. One example about our use case, so we doing machine learning, and one machine learning model is learned with several terabytes of data. And in general, when we use gradient descent and we execute this on 80 nodes, it takes 1 hour. So if we would just execute it on one node, it would take several days to learn our model, which is not reasonable, because for models we use, which is basically logistic regression models, it's quite important to have an up-to-date model. So the model should be up-to-date like for some hours, and then we learn it and we use a new model. Otherwise, our performance gets degraded quite quickly. Also, we launch thousands of jobs, many, many jobs running in parallel. So people run Spark, TensorFlow, Dask, different teams run different jobs. One other thing that is quite important for us is reproducibility. We want to build a reproducible application, which is quite important in machine learning, because if you do experimentation and you add a new feature, then you must be sure that your uplift in the metric is linked to this feature. If it's not the case, then just for random noise, then you will just work randomly. So what can be sources of non-determinism machine learning? Quite a lot. For example, depending on how you initialize your layer weights, you can have different results. If you do distributed training, you generally shuffle your data set, you get also different results. If you use deep learning and dropout, by design, you just take out random nodes. Most of the stuff you can fix it, because you can make care of always initializing your weights the same way when you do experimentation. You can take care of setting the random seed so that your shuffling is deterministic, and also that you always take out the same nodes. And the source I'm talking here of non-determinism is really updates to your dependencies or ML frameworks. So use Spark 2.4, new Spark comes out, and everything is different because the underlying implementation is changed. So it would be cool if we could somehow ship our whole environment. There are some talks in EuroPython about Docker. So obviously you could use Docker, which is quite cool, because if you interact with Python, you need an SQL server, you put it inside your Docker environment, and you know that you get the same environment. Nevertheless, Docker is difficult it's easier than virtual machines, but it's still difficult to master. You have a lot of options, you have to handle the ACLs. Docker file, I use it every day, but I still not getting really used to it. It's quite cumbersome, I find. Also to reuse them, does the Docker cache sometimes get messed up? So we are in a pure Python environment, and also what I'm including to Python world, I'm also including native libs. So TensorFlow uses C implementation, NumPy. So all this, to me, it's supported by wheels, which are pre-compiled Python packages. So for me, the Python world also includes packages that use native C APIs. And it would be nicer if you could just deploy our jobs in Python. Turns out you can do this with Conda. So you can just use Conda virtualenv. And like I showed before, you target the Conda virtualenv with your env variable. And the trick is basically what you do is you create your local conf virtual environment, and then you just zip it, push it to the cluster. When you are on the cluster, it gets unzipped, and then you just target the Python interpreter inside it. In our case, we started off with this because many people in data science use Conda. Basically everybody, I have the impression, uses Conda. But in our case, it's special because we have our own internal PyPI package repository. So which means we have Conda environments, and then we have to install stuff with pip inside our Conda environments. Why? Because when we started off, there was no open source implementation for having so we have our own code, we have to deploy it internally, and there was no open source implementation of the Conda package manager. And so it was quite easy for us. We used Nexus repository manager to set up a PyPI server, and we found it also more easier to just republish internal packages with pip. So we have our own PyPI package manager, and also we are big R&D, so we have like 600 engineers. And all data science people use Conda, but all people who are doing other stuff like tooling, web development, they use pip basically. So we had to choose. We choose this because it was easier for us. So basically, we ended up with using Conda and pip at the same time. And here's something I copied from last week from the Conda documentation. So what happens if you use Conda and pip at the same time. So you have to respect certain rules, otherwise it doesn't work. So we should only use pip after Conda, recreate the environment all the time and never use the root Conda environment. Also I tried out like again, like because when we like in the when we started off was like 1 year ago and it really didn't work very well. So I tried again last week. I have the impression it was much better now to mix Conda and pip. So there was a lot of stuff that has been fixed, but still when you use both, you see like you can end up with different versions of NumPy. So the main reason is they both don't have the same dependency graph. Conda does some optimizations by default, like it's activating MKL and packaging stuff differently. So basically you can end up with some inconsistent environment. So spoiler ahead. So like we succeeded to deploy all those tools like TensorFlow, Spark without Conda. So we're just using Python standards. And I'm just sharing here how we did it. So this is when you use Python. The same trick we did before, you can do it with Python virtual environments. The good news also is Python virtual environments, now they are supported by default. So they are supported by default by Python 3. So basically what you just have to do is you call the Python interpreter of Python 3, the dash mwenv, and you create and it will get you a new virtual environment. And then you can just target on the remote node your virtual environment and execute. And it will be the same way. You ship your virtual environment, you ship it to distributed storage, and then you get, the Python interpreter, you target the right Python interpreter on your virtual environment, and it will work out. So it works out like 80% of the cases, but not all the time, because virtual environments, they're not designed to, they were not designed to be shipped on other nodes. You can have local symlinks that just target your local node, and then when you're in your remote container, it just won't work out. So here's where PEX comes in. So it turns out it would be nice if you just wouldn't have to zip your virtual environment, and you can just build a virtual environment from scratch and then just execute it like an executable. It's a functionality that Python has since a long time, which is called self-executable zip file, specified in PEP 441. And basically what this does is you just put your zipped environment into a file and you put the shebang with the Python interpreter. And when you execute this, the bash will execute the Python interpreter, and then it's able to target all the zipped content from inside this file. So basically it's like the Java equivalent to UberJars, where it's used all the time. So you have an executable, everything is packaged inside and you can just execute it and it will work out. You can distribute it, you can put it everywhere and you're sure it works. So the Python default implementation, it's the only thing where we don't use Python standards. So the zip, there's Python zip app, but it didn't work. We didn't succeed to make it work. So what we're using is PEX, which is just another implementation of this, this standard. And what is cool about PEX is, you have a nice API, you have a nice CLI where you just pass all your requirements and you get the output and executable file. When you do this, PEX will build a wheel. When you have a source distribution, it will take the source distribution and compile your wheel. And also you can have some flags, like you could say, I want it really to be self-contained, I want to use nothing else. Or you could target the Python, you could just say that you want to use stuff from the Python path from the outside world. Can be handy, you will see later. So here's the schema again on how to use this with PEX. So basically you create your PEX archive, you push it to the storage, and then you just target, instead of the Python interpreter or targeting the virtual environment, you just target your executable PEX file, basically. And then when the Spark task will execute, it will target your executable file, and it will work with the same options as the Python interpreter. So you can use models, you can use scripts, or you can also use just the .py file. So here's how it looks at the command line. So I'm creating a PEX with pandas, pyro, PySpark. And then I just, when I launch this PEX by default, what will happen? It will just create the default Python interpreter. And then I can import all the stuff, everything's inside. Using the PySpark gel, it looks like this. So I'm setting my end variable, and then I just set another flag where I instruct Spark to ship it to the cluster. Spark will take it from the cluster, and then everything will work out. So this is nice. So the next thing is, you see, it's quite it's not very reproducible, because you have to set end variables, you have to set you have to set different variables. Your application code is in Python. So what you could do now is you put all this stuff in Python. You say, I want to build a reproducible module, and I build my Spark context in Python. So I define something like Spark session builder, where I create a Spark session. I set my end variable, and I can, I can move all the stuff to some reproducible, to some reusable function, and somebody uses this, it's sure it's using, it will set everything as is, and it will work. So my application code, I just put it to a function. And PEX also, I can create it from the command line, but I can also create it just with a function in the Python API. So I create the PEX and just upload it. And then I just assemble all those methods I create a current package, I create a main model, I just assemble them all in one method. And what I can do now is just, I launch the Python interpreter, and I just call my main Py, and this will do everything, all the magic. So it will create a Spark context, ship, create the PEX, ship your PEX, upload it to the cluster, and everything will be available. And you just can use Visual Code, you change one line, you ship it again, and everything will be available on your distributed job in a reproducible way. And then when you are ready for prod, you take it to prod, and it will work as is. Here's the schema again. So this is nice now, but it's reproducible, but slow. But basically, so you create your packs, and it takes like 1 minute to create it. Well, the reason is the pip resolver, but basically all packaging is slow. So you create create packs, use pip, use conda, or even Docker, everything basically is slow. Nothing is really fast, but you want to iterate fast when you develop. So 1 minute to just launch a job, it's quite long time to wait. So the next idea would be how you could separate code that you just develop, and your dependencies that always stay the same. So one idea is how to do this is use pickling, which is used by some tools, which is used by PySpark, Ray. You know. So basically, what the pickling in Python is serializing your Python functions. So basically, you serialize you have a function, you serialize it. It gets serialized to a binary stream. You can put this binary stream to a file, and then it's just on the cluster. It gets just loaded, unpickled, and you execute this. So with pickle, just pickle doesn't work, because pickle just will keep the name of your functions. But there's another library for distributed computing, which is called Cloud Pickle, which will pickle your function, the content of your function, and dependent functions, basically. So you have a function, you pickle it, and then you can just re-execute it on the remote node. It's already used by PySpark. So when you define a vectorized UDF or when you define a custom function, you see mean function, and you just push it in some magic to the execution graph. Basically, what PySpark will do, it will pickle it and unpickle it on the cluster. Well, the hick with this is, you know, we want to build reproducible applications. So we have moved all of our code to some shared package that we can reuse. So packages are not pickled. And also, I won't go into the details of this ticket, but pickling in Python, it's quite difficult, and there are a lot of issues with it. It's like a lot of cases where it doesn't work. For example, this case. I won't go into the details, but sometimes you can just up with code that doesn't work. So the idea would be now, like, you remember, we put everything in the current package. So what we can do now, like, there's already a Spark function that where you can upload dynamic files. So you can just zip your current package where you're working in and just upload it all the time. And it means that your code magically will be available. And you can even do this from multiple packages because you have the editable mod from pip. So basically, you every package you develop, you put it in editable mod. And then when you do pip list, you see that you have the information where it's installed. So basically what you can do, you take all those packages and you upload them all the time. So all those packages are uploaded all the time. And what you can do now, like you separated really dependencies that never changes and dependencies that always changes. So those that always change, you upload them all the time. And all the PEX archive, like the TensorFlow and PySpark dependencies, what you should do now, you put them for once for all on the distributed storage and reuse them all the time. And you, it's much, much faster. It's quite well. If you want to iterate fast, then you can really launch a job instantly. So I promised also S3 storage. So how can you connect Spark to S3? How can you push to S3 storage easily? Well, you have a lot of packages already available. One cool one is the one that is developed by the Dask guys, which is called S3 FS, which is a layer on top of the default bot2core, the default Amazon stuff. And basically the API, it's like a POSIX style, so like a Linux bash style, and also using default Python stuff. Like for opening a file, you just do open, you take your bucket, you take your archive, and then you can just read and write to it. You can also just list some files. So you can basically just use this to upload your file to distributed storage. And then what you need to do is you need to instruct Spark to use your distributed files. So it's also some flags, just you pull the jars, you instruct Spark to use S3 file system. And then, you put some helpers, you upload your env, and then you, based on the same method we defined before, you can just upload your env to S3 and you reuse it from S3. And if you want to use other stuff like Google Cloud Storage File System or Azure Blob Storage or HDFS, it's quite easy because S3FS will inherit from another package, which is just the interface with the APIs, which is called FSSpec. So if you respect this, all the other implementations are compatible. So you can push to every file system and then just instruct Spark or TensorFlow to use this file system. So nearly done. So as a sample implementation, we have put all the stuff into our own package, which is called ClusterPack, which is just following this workflow. So it's supporting Python packs. So you can push to Amazon S3 and Adobe HDFS. And then when you use TensorFlow, you just get the default builders. For Spark, you get default builders. So you get basically everything set up. It's just the wrapper on all the stuff I just showed. So if you show the same example again, I just upload my env, connect Spark to S3, add the package environment, add editable requirements, then I execute my example, and magically everything will work. Distributed way, you can do this for thousands of jobs, and it's just magic. So what about Conda? So basically, you have seen that basically the main idea is still, nevertheless, you invoke your Python interpreter remotely. So this works for PEX, but you can do the same with Conda. If you have all the stuff in place, you have all the APIs in place, basically what you just do is you add the additional SIP on your Conda environment, SIP it, push it, and then you invoke the Python interpreter the right way. So we still have this support. We still use this for sometimes because, one difference with Python, with pip and Conda is that Conda embeds the Python interpreter. And and other stuff, you need to have the Python interpreter on system level. So if you want to experiment stuff with Python 3.9, I'm not sure exactly if it's already supported by Conda, but it would be nice. If it's supported, or Python 3.8, we're still using Python 3.6. But you can just do some experimentation with Conda and well done. We don't use this in production, but it's still nice sometimes to use this. Also TensorFlow, honestly, it's the same idea. It's the same idea. It's even easier because you don't have to Spark submit. Basically, what you do is TensorFlow distributed. TensorFlow is really following the MPI style. You define your function, you put all the TensorFlow stuff inside, you push it to storage, and remotely on each node you want to execute, you invoke the Python interpreter, you invoke your main.py, basically. And then the execution workflow will start, and your distribution framework will take care of stopping the execution workflow, synchronizing gradients if necessary, and then moving on. So as you just target the Python interpreter, you can target virtual environment, you can target packs, you can target everything. It's the same idea. So we're finished a bit earlier. That's all I had to say. So I can take questions if there's some.
Cool. Okay. So thank you very much. Thank you for presenting. Have a good day and okay. See you next year, I hope.
Yes. Thank you.